So I would like to indulge myself. Generally, when I'm speaking to officers of the military or BSF, mm-hmm. I stick to the very regimented kind of line. So here I hope I would, you would allow me a bit of leeway into some of the sociological aspects if possible.
Mm-hmm. No, we have been working. In fact, one of our policy briefs was on counter-radicalization, why India needs a counter-radicalization strategy. So it is also on the web. So it was a longish speech which was done by the students themselves. Mm-hmm. So they highlighted how we have failed with regard to larger counter-radicalization strategy, because that holds a core to counter terrorism from sociological and psychological aspects. From that grievance mechanism which is existing need to be really taken care of. So we thought it's good to really get you engaged on this. So that's all. Let's see why these guys are just not joining, or have we joined a completely different sort of a seminar room as such. So just give me a second. Let me check with these guys. Okay. We will be having 40 minutes of your lecture and near about 30 minutes of question and answer, because we keep it very short and crisp, so that people's attention is there. The people are all around. So mm-hmm. 1 hour, 15 minutes is that we really look into. 45 mm-hmm. minutes, 50 minutes, you can go, no problems. Mm-hmm. But we need to put more sufficient space for the students to really raise questions in this regard.
Okay.
Thank you. So let me check with this. I will be back in a jiffy. Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
And then we have 3 to 4 research associates. I'm really sorry about this detail. We're just trying to get this fixed. For some reason, the link is being a problem. So just give us a few minutes. So sorry.
If you allow me, I can start my presentation, because it will dwell into some philosophical issues to begin with. So they may not lose anything very specific to start off with. And then when I'll come to the India issues and other things, by that time they would be joining in. So
please go ahead. So okay. Shall we start? Okay. There will be people who will be joining. It's a Saturday and it's a chilly Saturday.
I have a very longish presentation, so I'll try to curtail it, but I don't want to start very late and then make it worse for myself. And
No. Please.
Okay. So one of the major issues which we face around the world today is that how do we view terrorism? And I think that is very important to know, because based on the diagnosis, we can know what could be the solutions and how do we counter terrorism. And the big question which we are facing is that, is terrorism or violent extremism a problem in itself, or is it a symptom of a major sociological or a civilizational issue? And what is actually radicalism and what is actually extremism? And here we find that there is a greater debate which is going on these days, that probably the global order, which was based on liberalism and liberal democracy, that is under threat. And it is these various atavistic ethnic, religious, and other forces which are pushing back against globalization. They are trying to reassert themselves, and terrorism and violent extremism is a manifestation of it. So if we are just looking at it as a security problem, we may not be able to perhaps ever address the issue. We have to see it in its broader context and from where this problem is actually emerging. And here it has to be understood that we are what Matthew Arnold said once when we were in the pre-Victorian age of feudalism, and industrialization was coming up and feudal order was collapsing and a capitalist order was coming in. that there was a lot of societal tensions and socio-political tensions at that time. And he used the words wandering between two worlds, one dead, the other powerless to be born. And so it is that kind of a turmoil that the post-World War II kind of a order which came into existence, that is somehow now being challenged. And the strange thing is that when we look at many of contemporary political scientists and thinkers, there is a wide-ranging consensus that we may already be in a post-liberal world where the consensus on democracy and the Washington consensus at that is itself fraying at the edges, to put it lightly. And with various surveys by Pew and The Economist and others, a large number of people are saying that their faith in the democratic order, in liberal Western values is fast eroding. And that's why we find that even popular movements in the West, Yellow Vests in France and the Occupy Wall movement in the US and others, they are complaining that probably big business and corporations have bought off democracy. So there is a sense that probably democracy is not representing the voice of people, or somehow the present apparatus of governance is not as reflective or representative of the aspirations of the people as it should be. And even the global institutions, they are in a state of decline. When you look at the UN, when you look at even the World Health Organization in the with the outbreak of the pandemic, the World Trade Organization because of the conflict between China and US. So the whole order which came into existence after the Second World War, that is under a lot of stress and strain. And we find that throughout the world, the emphasis has shifted from a more consensus-based democratic dispensation to a strongman leadership. We find from China, Xi Jinping, Putin, Erdogan, Sisi, MBS, all these very strongman leadership is looked upon, like Caesar had was trying to take over in his time, the Roman Empire, the democratic setup. And so that is the kind of tension which is going on. This is obviously what people generally believe, that the pace at which globalization has happened, the global society was not quite ready for that level of assimilation and coming together. And so it's a pushback of that atavistic, ethnic, religious, and other nationalistic societies against the globalized order which neoliberalism tried to bring in at the onset of the 21st century. And we also find that there is this pronounced interest in fundamentalism. It's a kind of a postmodern pathology. You have you started off the 20th century with ideals of modernism, that somehow the scientific temper, rationality, and the capacity of the human mind to actually make progress steadily, ever finding newer and better ways of living. But with postmodernism in 1950s and afterwards, we find that that also has somehow receded. There's people have questioned the objectivity of science itself, and the whole idea that objectivity is nothing but the subjectivity of the people who are in power. And that kind of a revision with coming of ideas, even in the philosophical domain of post-structuralism, deconstruction, with even big international organizations like P5 at the UN being chastised for being elitist and others. So there was a complete breakdown in the kind of structures and the hierarchy of reason as it was understood at that time. And that has reflected upon the psyche within the 1970s, 80s, and even earlier, the liberal world questioning some of the values and putting truth under quotes and democracy under quotes and all the concepts which the media, the general government media propagates, everything was put under the scanner. And so there was an erosion of trust with political thinkers like Foucault and Chomsky, even stating that the present modern state, nation state is tyrannical and all that. And so out of that level of uncertainty, which postmodernism brought about, even in those concepts which were considered to be full of value and meaning, the decline in meaning created a new sense of uncertainty. And after that, in the 21st century, we find that there is a pushback even against postmodernism. People want to give meaning to life. And that's why they are reverting to faith, because reason keeps you in perpetual state of doubt. And science and technology is seen as the handmaiden of the big elite, the 1% corporate enterprises. And so when reason does not actually give you all the answers, when there is so much uncertainty, economic, social, and political, and in an individualistic world, the individual is not able to make his or her own mark in a capitalist order full of competition, there is a reversion towards a religion where you have a more collectivist ideology, where you get some kind of a psychological relief, self-righteousness, and an imagined sense of purpose. And so we find that the assertion of trying to give values to life, of honor, of your own ethnic religious origins, of trying to find meaning and purpose in life, that has become a very strong trend. It started off in a big way in the Muslim community, but then it is also spreading in other communities of the world. And sociologists like Anthony Giddens has done wonderful work in studying fundamentalism and the coming back of tradition in that respect. And so the term radical is also something which we need to understand. When we bandy words like radicalism, when we use terms like extremism and terrorism, we cannot use them indiscriminately, nor should we use them synonymously. The idea is that the word radical itself, which comes from the Latin word radix, in the political domain means a person who wants to uproot the existing socio-political order. Now, it is in itself, it doesn't have a negative or positive connotation. In fact, many of the freedom fighters of the US anti-colonial movement, such as George Washington and Jefferson, they took pride in calling themselves radicals because they were against the rule of England. And the whole idea of liberalism and democracy actually came from, I would say, a kind of a radicalization of the masses, which is actually a very modern phenomenon. It started off with the ideals of liberalism, because in the medieval ages, the masses were never involved in the happenings at the political level. There were kings kingdoms and empires. They used to fight with each other, but they never depended on the opinion of the masses in taking their decisions. But this whole new movement of liberalism and democracy tried to involve the masses in order to get legitimacy and to create a new socio-political order. And so from then on, the word radical moved towards the leftist movements in the 20th century, and later on towards the latter half of the 20th century, we find it getting associated with the radical religious movements. The other thing when it comes to terrorism is that, as Gerald Simo said, one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. And so there was initially a lot of glorification of so-called terrorists. Mandela himself said, I was called a terrorist. There were 180 to 90 cases against me for fomenting so-called terrorist activities. And so there was people like Jefferson in their time, they were called terrorists. Che Guevara is still quite a fashion. He's called a rad in a more fashionable way. So that kind of a glorification of the terrorist and as a freedom fighter was always seen as a rebel against the oppressive, tyrannical political order. But the great thing about India is that Indian fight against colonialism and against oppression and tyranny gave us the great wisdom which came through Mahatma Gandhi. And that actually has been instrumental in framing our approach against terrorism, because the use of nonviolence and democratic means of expressing your dissent and of trying to actually evoke the good even in the so-called enemy, so that the other side also sees your point of view without actually pushing him to a place where, from where, because of violence and ego issues, the issue becomes unresolvable. And so that precedent of Mahatma Gandhi, of calling terrorism what it is, as he said that it is the weapon of the weak and not of the strong, that has actually given the Indian fight against terrorism and the whole approach of trying to engage even with those who are insurgents and who may have issues with authority, because India's freedom movement understood that there are times when people will rise up for some kind of a questioning of authority. And so the best process is to have a dual approach, not just using the army or the security agencies, but also to involve the political process in that. And that actually, by sticking to that line, we are in fact much better placed than other countries around the world, even democratic and around the world, who like to resort to nonviolent ways, even in our protests, which actually, if you look at, I'm not taking any partisan positions, but like the farmer movement which just happened, it shows that they, the Gandhian tradition is still alive in the country. And so various definitions have been given of terrorism, and the Indian definition of terrorism, I think I do not need to go into reading it out. I have put it on the screen out there. It's actually anybody who is threatens through an act of violence the integrity, security, and sovereignty of the country and attempts to strike terror among the people or of the country and harms its interests. The UAPA gives that definition, and earlier POTA, which was revoked in 2004, also gives the definition. Right now, the country is facing two or three major threats of terrorism. Jihadism is a major problem which we need to contest with. However, when you look at left-wing extremism, it has been in a steady state of decline over the last 10, 12 years. The insurgency in the Northeast has also receded dramatically, although suddenly it has come into the news in the last couple of months. The Sikh extremism, Sikh-based violent extremism is also to a large extent almost completely eliminated. So India's measures have been quite successful to a large degree when it comes to fighting terrorism, the only exception being the threat we face from jihadist terror in India. And this is despite some of the major issues which we have at a societal level, which foment this kind of behavior. And there are a lot of reasons which have been enumerated by many people, the politics of communalism and the criminalization of politics, the fanatic religious movements and the irresponsible statements sometimes made by our leadership and which appear in the media. The charges of human rights excesses, because of our democratic society, sometimes it gets overblown much more than sometimes than what may be the reality. And then the other issues of development and poverty and unemployment, which can be catalysts, but not the causes, to my mind, for terrorism. We have over the years also developed a lot of institutions when it comes to fighting terrorism. We have the usual intelligence agencies, the Intelligence Bureau, RAW, the Defense Intelligence Agency. But then after the 2008 terrorist attacks in Mumbai, the NIA came into existence with the aim of actually then instituting the NCTC, which we are still working at, a multi-agency center, as a first step towards that, in that direction. And then we had the National Security Guard, which it started off after the Operation Blue Star way back in 1984. We have these Black Cat Commandos, which now we have these units even in various states, these commando units, and attempts are going on to trying to integrate it at a more centralized level so that they, there is some kind of synergy and some kind of coordination between the central commando units and the state units. We have the Central Economic Intelligence Bureau, which looks into issues of terror funding and terror financing. The CRP and the CRPF and BSF and Border Security Force look into the infiltration of terrorism, terrorist activists and other people from across the border, because cross-border terrorism is one of our major problems. The National, the Narcotics Control Bureau is another organization looking into narco-terror. And so we have these institutions, we have been slowly developing them. The Joint Cipher Bureau, the Anti-Terrorism Squad, which is there in many of the states now, from Maharashtra to UP to Bihar. Many times even I am called by some of these units to give a talk against jihadism and all that. So the state investigating agency in Jammu and Kashmir and the various state level initiatives which are being done. The NAD grid is supposed to have come full online. I do not know anything about it. Probably it should have been operational, fully operational now, but I'm not privy to any information. It was said that probably by 2020, it would become operational. And so there are these several other institutions looking into the areas of counterterrorism. The only problem is that there has been a lot of talk that India does not have a full-fledged counterterrorism policy. And that is probably reflective of India's general aversion to actually being very strategically inclined. There has always been this criticism of India of not being strategically a developed country, although that has been also criticized in a big way. But people like Tanham way back in the 1990s said that we do not like to get trapped by publishing anything or getting into any overt strategic decision-making, which I think has also affected our decision-making when it comes to making counter-radicalization programs, because we are somehow wary that any initiative of the government or the state becomes a major political issue. Our own opposition parties take very strident stands against that. And so we have been very wary and chary of making overt responses and initiatives and making policies against terrorism and all that. If I look at the Northeast insurgency issue, I think we have made very good progress over the years. And now I think it is only limited to a very small region. We found that in Mizoram, we had this great precedent of Lal Denga actually becoming the chief minister of that state. He himself led an insurgency for 20 years. And it was the great wisdom of the central government at that time, by the Rajiv Gandhi government, that problem was resolved. And that's, I think, one of the great examples of how political involvement and resolution of these insurgencies through the political means actually gives a more lasting solution than just a security-oriented approach. The other issues around Northeast insurgencies have also come down in a big way, and some of the credit has been given to the coming of Sheikh Hasina in Bangladesh, because most of these insurgent groups were operating from that country. And also the influx of, I will talk about that later when I will talk about jihadism. But the continuing problem in Nagaland has also to a great extent been attended by the peace, by the peace talks which are happening, especially with the NSCN and many of its breakaway groups, which keep fighting amongst themselves. They are also involved in creating problems in Manipur and adjoining states. even as the PLA there last month in Manipur attacked some of our Assam Rifle Forces. 5 or 6 people were killed there. But if you look at the figures, in 2007, the killings in the Northeast by the insurgent groups was way up over 400 to 500. It has dramatically come down. In Nagaland itself, last year it had come down to single digits. This year, unfortunately, because of this recent incident which happened in the district of Mon in Nagaland, where 6 coal miners were first killed, and then the protests which happened thereafter, the actions by the alleged actions by the security forces led to the death of 8 more civilians. And so there is this protest which has started that the 1958 imposition of AFSPA, of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, should be revoked. And that in itself is, I would say, the argument coming from the chief ministers of that state themselves, who are actually aligned to the BJP, is because they say that the level of violent extremism has come down to that level, that probably it is a time that the army's involvement should be reduced. So that also is, in a way, I would say, is a positive development, and these small issues will keep on rising up. But the big problem has been, to a large extent, been settled, and we are moving in that direction, although issues remain. And same is the case maybe a lesser extent with the left-wing insurgencies. And today we find that an insurgency which was spread out to 180 districts around the country have come down to around 70 districts. And it's mainly confined to states like Chhattisgarh, West Bengal, Jharkhand, and few areas of Bihar. Otherwise, you had Andhra Pradesh, the Naxalbari and Naxalite movement has come down, their activities have come down dramatically. And also in Maharashtra, which actually spread to the Tamil Nadu state and many other areas, now it has been reduced substantially. That has happened because of various initiatives of the government. And one of them is that the approach of the Maoist is to go into the forest and go into the tribal areas and there give some kind of a healthcare, medical care, and a better governance to those people who are outside, according to them, the purview of the government initiatives. And so the government's own democratic development drive has countered the efforts of the left-wing extremists. And so it has been a double approach of not only taking action against the Naxalites, but also providing more development to these remote regions. So that dual approach has helped in curtailing it. And the present government has come up with a doctrine called Samadhan, with each letter talking about a special kind of approach, smart policing, aggressive strategy, motivation and training, actionable intelligence, development, which is actually very central to the whole exercise, harnessing of technology, making of action plans, and sapping terror funding. And just like the UK Home Office, India also has this 3 P's, the preempt, protect, and the prevent, as its 3-pronged Indian approach to fight against terrorisms, which they have very successfully applied when it comes to left-wing insurgency. So with preempt, it is a more assertive, proactive approach of early detection, interception, and preemption of terrorism-related activities. Protect goes for enhanced presence of security forces, community engagement, civil society, outreach programs, counter radicalization measures, and prevent is more into surveillance and detection. Now, I will come to the elephant in the drawing room, which is jihadism. When it comes to jihadism and the threat of jihadism for India, I would like to say that there are 3 sources of that. One is the least And it, I take heart by saying that the least disturbing of all is the homegrown terror groups, jihadist terror groups, which have also been curtailed thanks to our security forces in a big way. So the problems which Simi or Indian Mujahideen and other terrorist groups were creating now, they are no longer operational. Although some of their subgroups, we keep hearing about the Al-Umma group in Tamil Nadu or the base movement there or some Kerala-based terrorist groups are there. So first is the homegrown groups. Then we have this major transnational threat coming from the literature on the internet of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, especially ISIS, which was able to involve some of the coastal regions of India, especially the western coast, which is closer to the Gulf countries and to the Arab influence, and many of the expatriates from there, they were quite influenced by that ideology, especially the state of Kerala. But now we have also seen that from Southeast Asia, that is impacting some of our eastern coast. Tamil Nadu has been found to be more vulnerable to radical indoctrination coming from Southeast Asia, because there are many Tamilians who are working in Malaysia and Singapore. And so we have to keep that in check. There is also the influx of Rohingya refugees coming from Bangladesh, and some of the terrorist organizations already operating in Bangladesh, the GMB and others, and the proliferation of madrasas on the borders of Bangladesh, even of Nepal. So that is the other threat and the internet-based threat. But I think the bigger threat comes from, and where we do not give enough focus. You find many of these conferences and seminars talking about ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Although India has not been hit as much by these groups, and thankfully, but unfortunately, we still have this ongoing problem with Pakistan, which still has this hang-up of the partition and of trying to take revenge for the creation of Bangladesh. So they view India as being a conspirator in the splitting and of Pakistan itself. And that creates this three-pronged jihad, creates its own differences, and we need to understand where the cleavages lie. So it is true that the global jihadist, Salafi jihadist movement is a threat, and they always sometimes collude with the Pakistan-backed terrorist groups and also with the Indian home groups. The Indian homegrown groups get subsumed by the global jihadist groups eventually, or by a Pak-backed group. But the global jihadist groups are also against Pakistan. Even the TTP in Pakistan is now asking their followers that they should finish off the Murtad, the Pakistani government. Al-Qaeda actually attacked the Karachi port naval dockyard way back in 1916 and said that is the beginning of Ghazwa Hind for them, because according to them, Pakistan is also part of that Hind. For them, Hind is more of a region than a state. So there are times when the global jihadist groups collude with Pakistan-backed groups and also with the ISI, but there are also times that there are fissures in that. And the Pakistan-backed groups generally take the Pakistani national interests into account, and they are backed by their generals, and their methodology is also the same, whereas the global jihadists have their own agenda. So that also comes into clash. We need to understand that. We also need to understand, like, a group like Taliban is basically a Deobandi Hanafi group. It is not a Salafi jihadi. Although Al-Qaeda was more pan-Islamist and it had a better equation with the Taliban, because it was not highly Salafized, and most of its upper leadership was more Western educated, people like bin Laden and others. So at least they were not as dyed-in-the-wool Salafists. However, even in his time, people like Abu Qatada and later people like Zarqawi, and now the ISK, do not like the Taliban because they believe that Taliban is a Hanafi organization, although they are Wahhabis, and Wahhabis are dead against Hanafism. So we need to understand the differences within the jihadist movements. And sometimes there is collusion and sometimes there is actually a division in these. So in this slide, we don't have the time, though I could have discussed this matter in a bigger way. The bigger problem with jihadism is that, I do not know, we have more people with us now. I hope many of us have with us. So with jihadism is that most of these fighters, they may say that they have some political ends, but actually they don't have any political ends. You can negotiate with insurgents in Northeast. You can also win over the population in the tribal areas of India. But here, there is a new kind of an ideological concoction, which actually looks for a martyrdom, which finds its end in martyrdom itself. They fight to kill or die. So, and they are quite averse to negotiating. Some of these Salafi jihadist groups and extremely violent people, they have been equated with the Kharijites who first killed Ali, the Caliph Ali. And these people are against negotiation with anyone whom they consider non-believers. So how do you engage them? How do you bring them in the equation? Even Pakistan finds it difficult. So that is the threat which we are facing now. This is something which was not there earlier. We always had the conventional soldier of a foreign army or a subnational anti-national insurgent who had some political demands. So there was some rationality, some method to the madness. Here we are dealing with non-state, almost irrational actors. The other thing is that you always used to have the PSYOP operations. But here the PSYOPs is not done on the enemy army or their military or the state. It is done against a section of a population and trying to radicalize and recruit a section of the population into your fold so that that community actually carries out attacks on your behalf. And this is a completely new kind of PSYOPs which has started. The other threat which comes from jihadism is that it uses jujitsu politics, what we call jujitsu politics. It hides behind the population. It provokes the security agencies to take action against terrorists, which if at any time, if they become heavy-handed, they can use against that very power. So they hide behind the so-called values of civil liberties only to undermine them. Some of these Islamists even become part of the democratic movement to then later subvert it when they come to power, which is happening in many Arab countries. So the idea of the terrorists, jihadists, is to become part of the, to fully exploit the democratic and civil liberties of the present order in order to then subvert it and to create disillusionment even in the democratic forces against democracy, because the kind of limitations it puts on the security forces in fighting indiscriminate violence by the terrorists are such that they become frustrated. And so that is the whole game. They want to create that level of frustration so that the army is then questioned. And the very value system which the liberal world stands for comes into question. And so that is one of the techniques of these people. Religions all around the world, they have all sides to them, but generally religions were meant to be spiritual institutions and also ethical institutions. And one of their purposes was to curtail the bestial and the carnal side of you and arouse the intellectual and the spiritual side of human beings. In Islam, there was a lot of talk about apni nafs ki islah karo, try to curtail the bad side in you. Similarly, in Hinduism, we speak about indriyon pe vash karna, apne baser instincts ki upar kabu pana. I'm sorry, I've just diverted to Urdu. But the problem here is that religion is not the main issue here. They want to evoke that carnal side in you. They want to dabble. Surprisingly, these religious groups like people to have the visceral side to come out, the passions of hatred and anger and the feeling for revenge. So the shadow side is provoked in a way. What Carl Jung used to say, that the shadow self should also assert itself. They have taken it many notches higher. And so I would now like to come to, I do not know how much time I have spent and how much time do I have left. Kritika, can you tell me how much time can I?
Yeah, sir. You can go on for like half an hour, 1 hour more. That's totally
fine. Okay. So I have plenty of time. The thing which we have to understand here is that Islam, what we are facing right now is Islamism and political Islam. Islam has been turned into a political movement. And because it has been turned into a political, there's an attempt to make Islam into a political movement. There is always going to be a militant side to that political system, because you have to bring it as a political system in reality. Earlier, Islam, like other religions, was also just a religion. At the time of the Prophet and after his first four caliphs, whatever the Quran and Hadith talked about, they tried to lead a very puritanical life, and they had that system with them. But after 30 years of the death of the Prophet, most of that Islamic values were completely finished off, at least in the political domain. Islam, when you find the Umayyad Empire coming into existence, they never allowed Sharia to be used for whatever idea of Sharia may be at that time. And because the rulers at that time did not conform to the Prophet's ways, and they became above the law. So the Umayyads, the great incident of Karbala, is actually politically significant, because Hussein used to say that the new king is not following any of even supposedly draconian laws of Islam. He has become bigger than the laws of Islam and a law unto himself. And since then, we have found that throughout the Muslim empire, kings have used religion whenever it suited them. Otherwise, they completely ignored it. And when in the modern times, this kingship came to an end with the dissolution of the Ottoman Caliphate, where the king was also the caliph, the extremist religious elements thought now is the time to reimpose Sharia upon the world, which they were denied. And so we will find that this new Islamism talks about a reimposing of Sharia and thinking of Sharia as a political system. The big problem is that the Sharia is very silent on political matters. There is no political theory in Islam. You could, the Quran talks about David, who was a king, but the Quran, but the Prophet himself, he had a very egalitarian life. He was not a king. He did not have a political title. He had a state, but he had no cabinet. He had no constitution, politically speaking. He had no structure. He did not even have the time to give all that, because it was only in the last few years when he became the head of the state of Medina. And there also he was expanding his message. So he used the political system to spread the religion. He called himself Rasulullah, messenger. He did not ever call himself any political title. So the big debate in Islam has always been that, is Islam also political? If Islam is political, then what kind of a political system does Islam talk about? The Quran never mentions the word state. There is no idea of it. And barring a few punishments for some medieval wrongs of sodomy and of fornication and flogging and chopping of hands of thieves, the Quran does not go beyond that. So the idea that just put a woman under a burqa or just have a non-usurious banking system, beyond that, the Islamic world does not have a full-fledged idea of a political system. As a Muslim, Muslims have had kingship. Muslims have had an egalitarian system of tribal system. They could also be democratic, because the Prophet said that there should be consultative shura, which is a consultative body. So there could be enough room for a democratic system also. So as a religion, Islam mainly concerns itself with the metaphysical, what Islam's interpretation is of its own cosmology. And its practices, religious rituals and dogma. But when you come to study it very seriously, there is very little literature on politics. However, this whole new movement which started in the 20th century, and the main architect of that was Maulana Maududi of India. He came up with this idea that unless a Muslim cannot practice his faith individually, there should be a complete socio-political change. Islam can only be fully understood and come into its own if the whole muashra, if the entire milieu is changed, it becomes an Islamic society. And so the political, the way was to create a political change. And he used the Prophet's example that he became the head of the state of Medina, but he never wanted to become the head of the state of Medina. He was escaping Makkah, and in the process, the people of Medina made him the head of Medina. He was not from Medina himself. He was more of an ombudsman. So the whole argument of this new movement is that you have to grab political power, and then the kind of theology which was developed over the years after the Prophet and which had kings and all that, that kind of a distorted theology they are using as some kind of a Sharia. And their interpretations of jihad as like that, for imposition of so-called Islamic rule on both the Muslim world and around the world. There are people like Najam, the Bangladeshi scholar, who says that we should have a Sharia-based system even in Britain. Anjam Chaudhary. So in this context, I would like to then talk about a little about the term jihad itself. And there are many Islamic apologists who talk a lot about jihad. And many of their claims, if you research it, are to an extent quite true. We should understand that in the phase of the Meccan period, the first 13 years of Prophet's propagation of Islam, from the time of his, what Muslims call the prophethood was revealed to him at the age of 40, and to when he was 53 and he was in Makkah, there was no right to self-defense. So his followers were not asked to defend themselves even if they were attacked or killed. So many of his followers in the time of when the Prophet was in Makkah, he showed the other cheek, just like Jesus. And then, so it was only when he migrated to Medina and there were two tribes who made the Prophet into a head of state, and the city-state of Medina was attacked by Makkan and other tribes people, then as the head of the state of Medina, he defended Medina just like any other state. In fact, he wrote a constitution which is called Mithaq al-Madina, in which the rights of every citizen of Medina, if he is a polytheist, if he is a Christian, if he is a Jew, because all of them were there, all of them got equal rights, and there was no jizya in that. The charter is still existing. And this is the remarkable thing is that at the Devban, the Darul Uloom Devban in 1947 came up with a fatwa that the Indian constitution, because it is secular, is more Islamic because it is like the Mithaq al-Madina. So when we study this aspect, and in all the schools of Islamic law, jihad is fardal kifaya. If you see the five principles of Islam, they are Tawheed, Hajj, Roza, Namaz, and Zakat. There is no mention of jihad in that. Jihad is not a fard. But the whole idea got changed once the religion became an empire under the Umayyads. And then there was this hubris that we have become a big power and we have to try to impose upon people our writ. And what was earlier taken as a tribute in borderline areas from people, the jizya system, which was only on the borderline areas, that was imposed on all non-Muslims in the Islamic empire. And then a new theology came into existence with words like Darul Kufr and Darul Islam, and then Darul Sulb. That came mainly from theologians like Al-Tabari, who are not the Prophet and all that, but they were more of a strategic experts. And when the Mongols came and hit the Muslim Empire big time in 1258, then there was this ideology of compromise also which came in. So much of the political rhetoric throughout the history of Islam has got entangled with the theological evolution of the religion. And sometimes Al-Qaeda and ISIS uses that rather than the Islam of the beginning, although they claim that they are going back to the Salaf and the original followers of it. So that's why there are these very clear verses in the Quran. The Prophet says that jihad in its militant sense, the soldiers should not lay hands on the old, on women, on children, on babies. Abu Bakr says that the first caliph, do not commit treachery while fighting, do not mutilate dead bodies, which Pakistan does. And all these injunctions are there. Do not even attack any non-Muslim priests. Do not attack the flock. Do not corrupt the environment. Do not burn the trees, the fruit-bearing trees. The Quran itself says that do not cross the limits. Only fight those who are fighting you. Do not fight against those who are not attacking you. The word kafir is not for the idolaters. The word kafir is for anyone hostile to the Prophet. The word for idolaters in the Quran is mushrik. So the whole idea of demonizing every non-believer into a kafir is also something which happened later. So there have been issues with the Muslim world. The Muslim world, the Muslim kings have done a lot of atrocities, but that was the way the medieval age was. So being an apologist for Aurangzeb or people like that makes no sense. However, this new movement is completely different from that. This new threat is actually of coming mainly from a Salafi jihadist ideology. And it is trying to, because it does not follow any of the four schools of Islamic law, even the four schools of Sunni Islamic law. The four schools of Sunni Islamic law are Hanafi, Shafi'i, Maliki, and Hanbali. Now, the Salafi movement is more like the Protestant movement of the Christians, because it does not follow the Catholic Church. It does not follow the four schools of Sunni Islamic law. In the four schools of Sunni Islamic law actually put this prohibition that only the head of a state can declare jihad. No mullah, no mufti has the right to declare jihad. And bin Laden, because he was a Wahhabi who does not conform to any of the four schools of Islamic law, and Wahhabism is against the Islamic four orthodox schools of Islamic law. Being a Wahhabi, he issued a fatwa of jihad against America and left all Muslims to fend for themselves. But that happens because he comes from a breakaway sect. So this whole idea that Saudi Arabia is actually practicing orthodox Islam is completely wrong. Saudi Arabia, when it came into existence with the Wahhabi sect, its new fiqh, its new system and interpretation was called fiqh-e batil, the fiqh of evil, by all the Muslim world. And then the petroleum and the petrodollar helped it to win over all those sects who were against Saudi Arabia. And if you look at the early 1960s and 70s fatwas, even from Deoband, which is a Hanafi organization, it was against Saudi Arabia. But once the money kept pouring in to the madrasas, the rhetoric changed completely. So we should understand from where this new threat is coming. And in that, America, which wanted to fight the Soviet Union and made Saudi Arabia its ally, used the Wahhabi ideology to its advantage. And over a period of time, even the Sufis became greatly Salafized. Today, we find the Tehreek-e-Labbaik in Pakistan actually threatening the government over the Prophet's caricatures and all that. So I have listed down here the gradual changes in Islamic law which Wahhabi sect has tried to introduce, although the laws will stand for those who believe in it. But they have been making those changes, and they have been using a lot of what we like to hear, ijtihad. We talk about reforming Islam. Bin Laden has done a lot of ijtihad. Bin Laden said terrorism is completely kosher now, because in the new world, in the new warfare, you cannot not kill the civilian. You don't have clear enemy lines. You are in the fourth generation of warfare. It's all urban warfare. So you can hit the institutions. So he hit the Pentagon and some of America's business centers. But then came Zarqawi and other people who said, what about collateral damage? Why can't we just cleanly do ethnic cleansing and wipe off Christians and the unfortunate Yazidis? And so we find at every stage, this new ideas are coming into the fold of the terrorist ideology. They use verses of the Quran completely arbitrarily. Even the Surah Al-Saf, which is called the sword verse, which is the main contentious verse of the Quran, which is the fifth verse of the ninth Surah, nobody reads the full line. Nobody reads the full line. The full line itself says that after the four months have passed. So there is obviously a context to that. So it is referring to a certain 4 months. It is referring to a treaty which was signed. And despite the treaty having been signed, the forces of Muhammad were being attacked. So the forces of Muhammad were asked not to retaliate for 4 months because they have to stick to the treaty. And the next verse says, do not, after four months, you can attack those who are attacking you. You can even go on the aggressive. But do not attack those tribes against Muhammad who are abiding by the treaty. The very next verse says that. And you would be surprised that the forces of Muhammad included non-Muslims. And the whole incident which is being referred to, which is the conquest of Makkah, the allies of Muhammad included tribes like Banu Khuza, who were idolaters, who were polytheists, whom Muhammad was against. So this whole discourse, Muhammad could not convert all of Arabia in his own lifetime. It happened over a period of 50-100 years. He himself was more of an assimilator than a person who created dissensions, because it is not physically possible to convert the entire population to one kind of a religion or ideology. It is the mullah who keeps on insisting that being the prophet, he was able to convert the entire population. So when we look into Islam and its religion, it has gone through a lot of narratives and a lot of changes in the narratives. And so, unfortunately, the narrative which is predominant at the present time and over the last 100 years and over the last 150 years, mainly because of the decline of the Muslim power. The idea was that the Muslim world was ruling the roost, had Africa and Asia and parts of Europe in its sway. There was no America at that time. There were no North America, no Australia, no South America. And suddenly there was enlightenment in the European world. And so the very expansion of Europe came at the expense of the hegemony of the Muslim empire, which stretched from Spain to Philippines. And that's why the Muslim world has been reluctant to imbibe Western values, the Western education system. It has always looked upon even the more liberal and assimilative values with suspicion. And that is why there is a continuing backlash against whatever the West does, more than any other community around the world. And because it is spread to a much wider expanse across the continents. I had just listed some of these tenets. When it comes to India, it has to be understood that the early Islamists of South Asia, I could go on and on with it, but I would not like to dwell too much into it. And I have also listed down some of the major jihadist groups. Pakistan was basically founded at the time of the partition of India by some of the big nawabs and the elite of the Muslim community, which felt that a new dispensation, the Muslim power, would not be as it was earlier. And so they wanted to preserve their power. So they thought that with the Hindu population coming from the Pakistan region, they could go and usurp those places, and they would remain the Vaderas and the big Nawabs over there. And to some extent, they have continued over there like that because feudal order has not been, Zamindari system has not been revoked in Pakistan. So it was more of a feudal order, which it was more of a communal motivation that people at that time made Pakistan. However, it became more and more religiously oriented with the coming of General Zia, with the Bangladesh coming into existence. Pakistan felt it very badly. They went to the extent of executing their president and prime minister, Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto. And then General Zia came up with this idea that they should also do the same kind of insurgencies in India. They somehow blamed India for fomenting the Mukti Bahini insurgency. And so that gave them, put them into this trap of revenge that we have to somehow avenge it, maybe in Kashmir, maybe in Punjab. And that was the motivating factor. And so this new general, General Zia-ul-Haq, who came after disposing of Bhutto, was also then at that time very influenced by the rise of the Wahhabi and the Mujahideen. And he was a facilitator of the Mujahideen movement in the late 1970s and 80s. And so he used the jihadism and tried to make Pakistan more Islamized. And he started a system of trying to have an alternate system of criminal justice. He started the idea of whipping, stoning, and amputating people's hands. Also started the government taking the zakat tax directly from the people, and he started Islamizing Pakistan. And since that time onwards, he also started creating these non-state actors, starting with the Jamaat-e-Islami. He in fact had Maududi as one of his main advisors for the last few years Maududi was alive. Maududi died in 79 and he comes in 77 or 78. But for that little bit of time, he tried to get Maududi's blessings for his Islamization drive. And Maududi, surprisingly, was more of a moderating person. He said that if you will go overboard, you would face the consequences. So have a more gradualist approach. Zia was trying to go hammer and tongs over that. But then it is the Jamaat-e-Islami, which surprisingly is not violent but very radical organization. It is the main organization from which most other terrorist organizations have come out in Pakistan. And Jamaat-e-Islami was used mainly to counter the Muhajir movement because Jamaat-e-Islami supporters were also predominantly coming from UP and other areas of India in Pakistan. They were the Muhajirs. So Jamaat-e-Islami was set up mainly to counter the Muhajir threat to the Pakistani state. And from Jamaat-e-Islami, the Hizbul Mujahideen came out and many other organizations have come out which are attacking the Kashmiri province. The whole idea of the Pakistan military being that they would like to bleed the Indian army and the Kashmiri people without directly attacking Kashmir because they don't have the strength, and also because they want to keep the Kashmir dream alive. They know that once Kashmir comes into the hands of Pakistan, it would also be another sob story as it is in Balochistan and in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. So keeping the paradise-like dream alive keeps the hungry Pakistani have this delusion that they have something to achieve. It gives a sense of purpose to the Pakistani. The Pakistani military has on its rolls many of these hungry, naked people it cannot feed. So they are sent to madrasas. The parents just send their children to the madrasas where they are not made into Islamic scholars, but into fighters, into jihadis. It's a whole factory of jihadis, which madrasas have become there. And then they are being thrown into Kashmir through various organizations which are there. Then there is also this growing Deobandi sect is a very strange kind of a movement. I'm not calling it a sect. It's a very strange kind of movement which tries to marry Sufism with Salafism. But over a period of time, it has become more Salafized and it has completely moved away from its Sufi origins. So the Barelvi Sufis are actually Barelvis are closer to Sufism. Devbandis have a splintered mind. Sometimes they go Sufi and sometimes they go more Salafi. The Barelvis actually accuse the Devbandis of being closet Wahhabis and Salafis. And so the Devbandis who were the Darul Uloom Devband of India, although it completely disaffiliated itself from Pakistani groups and from Taliban, and they said that they have moved on the issue of jihad and politics, they have their own ideology. Still recently, we find that even the leaders of the Devbandi movement, they have a lot of sympathy because they have found in the Taliban a virtual political power. So even the Indian Darul Uloom Devband is more ambivalent, tries to find some kind of political capital and wants to probably impress upon the Indian state that it can help them in finding some kind of a deal with them. So we find that the Devbandi movement is somewhat in between when it comes to its loyalties. So it is from this extremist Salafization of even the Devbandis, we find these groups coming up like Sipah-e-Sahaba, which considered the Shia to be the first group they should target, worse than even the Jews and the non-Muslims. It is the Shia. The Sipah-e-Sahaba, the Lashkar-e-Jangvi, which actually today, sometimes it is said whether it is the ISIS which has attacked the ISK, which has attacked the Shia population, or it is still remnants of the Lashkar-e-Jangvi. The Harkatul Mujahideen, the Tehreek-e-Taliban. The Tehreek-e-Taliban is nothing else but the Taliban of Afghanistan. It is just that because it is on the Pakistani side of the border, they want to further radicalize Pakistan, and they want to make Pakistan non-modern. They want to completely radicalize and Islamize Pakistan in totality, which Pakistani Jinnah-oriented people still resist. So that is the thing which is going on within Pakistan, because it was a state created in complete confusion, not knowing what it stands for other than being anti-India and anti-secular India. And it still does not know what is Islam and what kind of a political system it should pursue. And then in Kashmir, we have an ecosystem of terrorism which has developed. We find Jamaat-e-Islami and many of the extremist organizations actually creating a base. And they talk about why Kashmir should not be part of India. One should be very clear in understanding that initially the Kashmiris did not like Pakistan. The Kashmiris themselves have a great sense of exclusivity about them. Even if it is the Kashmiri Pandit, he likes to see himself a little different from the other Brahmins of North India. He would generally not even look at many of the other mutts of India. So there is a sense of being exclusive. If you look at the Kashmiri Muslim, he hardly sits with the what they call North Indian Muslims. So they don't equate themselves as North Indian Muslims. They will say, "Tum North Indian Muslims jo ho, ye karte ho." So they will not participate in Indian Urdu Mushairas. You will hardly find any Kashmiri poet, any Indian Muslim ever marrying into a Kashmiri. The Kashmiris have this sense that they are somehow quite different from the rest of the world. So they have this sense of exclusivity. To some extent it is, I mean, I can only say this, there are people who say that even it is the case with the Kashmiri Hindus. So they have this sense of nationality and pride about them. We cannot discount that. And they also do not completely trust Pakistan. They do not like anyone to come under the influence of any big state whatsoever. And they have this whole idea that somehow they could make a Switzerland and become a country which is which will not be violated by any of the three big powers surrounding it. So that is some kind of a dream which they have. But over the years, they have become increasingly radicalized by the Islamist idea. And Pakistan has been at the forefront of radicalizing them. And predominantly the idea has come from the Jamaat-e-Islami idea. And if you go to Kashmir, you will find in many of the bookshops and many of the libraries, a lot of Jamaat-e-Islami literature. And what it does is sometimes we try to underplay the importance of the radical literature. Maududi is a philosopher. Maududi has studied Fichte and Nietzsche and most of the Western Enlightenment literature. He talks about a sovereignty, which is quite different from the concept of sovereignty in other Muslim literatures. He says that sovereignty is a theological concept because it only behooves of God to have so much power in his hands. No human being can have sovereignty. So he's much of an anarchist, unlike most of Islamist literature, which talks about a sultan having absolutist power. His brand of Islam is more of verging towards anarchism. And some of these political ideas appeal to the modern Western educated Muslim. So we need to understand this, that there are these nuances which make some of these Islamists more closer to, in their appeal to even the Western educated Muslims. And generally the Western educated Muslims, once they come out of their schools and universities, they develop a sense of guilt that they are not good Muslims, that somehow they were not given Islamic education. And then in their mid-20s or later teenagers, they want to learn all about that. And then they go to these websites and in the process get radicalized. So somehow this new kind of pseudo-modern literature coming from Jamaat-e-Islami or coming from Iran or other places, and Al-Qaeda and ISIS definitely, that is able to seduce these people because it is not completely nonsensical to the extent that it talks about certain modern ideas and tries to justify in their own way the cause of the Islamist cause. So we have to be careful about it. It is from here that most of the problems come. Unlike the jihadi making madrasas in Pakistan, madrasas are not a major threat anywhere else in the world. Because if you study only Islamic theology and history, you will find that there are many, many issues there. So a real Islamic scholar would not be as belligerent or as radicalized. It is these modern educated people who have little understanding of Islam and the issues therein, who are actually drawn in by some of the philosophical terminologies used by the Islamists and their polemic against the existing socio-political order. Now, when it comes to radicalization in the eastern sector, you have the problem of Rohingya refugees because they are indistinguishable. You cannot make out from their features whether they are Indian or Bangladeshis or Rohingyas. So we do not know the extent to which they have spread into India. They were said to be responsible for some of the blasts which took place in Bodh Gaya way back in 2013. There are also a lot of madrasas which have come up on the borders of West Bengal. 450 odd madrasas are reported officially, but there may be many more. They are generally said to be a JMB and more radical madrasas. On the Nepal side also, about 300 odd madrasas have been talked about. 2014, there was a blast on our side of the border in Burdwan, and many of these plans of these terrorist organizations were thought about. So we somehow give too much importance to the threat coming from Pakistan, but it is also from this side that, from the eastern side, that this threat is growing. And so we find that this is also getting enmeshed with the problem of organized crime, cattle smuggling, fake currency notes and all that. And also narco-terrorism, which is there on the Pakistani side. India's approach in fighting jihadism, especially when it comes to Kashmir, it is more of a hands-on security-based approach. But otherwise, when it comes to young people getting radicalized in other parts of India, we have been very rightly, we have not tried to give it the oxygen of publicity, which could actually make it much bigger. We have tried to isolate cases of radicalization and try to involve families, the community elders and civil servants, civic society members, trying to involve them so that the problem is nipped in the bud itself. So it has been a more nuanced, unobtrusive approach. Police forces of various states have started major campaigns. You find in Kerala, the Jan Maitri movement, which has actually done wonders. It has involved the people there. Operation Pigeon has been started to stop possible young people moving to so-called Islamic destinations of ISIS and in Afghanistan. There are these major religious counseling initiatives, very successful at that, in Maharashtra. Maharashtra has a special problem because there the radicalization is also involves the criminal underworld over there. So every state has its own kind of problem of radicalization. So there is no uniform policy to fight against radicalization all over India. Every state has been given liberty to tackle the issue on its own, which has actually helped India more than if you have overt policies of counter-radicalization, having these big institutes like Quilliam Institute in Britain or others, which actually indulge in de-radicalization. And then there is this problem of recidivism where you find many radicalized people reverting to their old ways, and that brings down, raises question marks on the program itself. India has been doing things on the down low and very in a less obtrusive manner, and so that has yielded better results. I have listed all of them there. The other thing is that because the West, in the West, people are driven more by ideology. India is a more society plays a major part in the upbringing of a child, and so that has somehow insulated India from the kind of virulence which has ideological virulence which has infested much of the world. There are other reasons also, because India has its own versions of Islam. I would not say that the Indian versions of Islam, Deobandi Islam, or even the Sufi Barelvi Islam are moderate, as is generally said, but it is an Indian theological school which always competes with the Arabian Islamic schools. Here we do not know much about Imam Ghazali or Ibn Taymiyyah or many of the Arab scholars, or even about Abdul Wahhab. We have our own Islamic scholars, Ashraf Thanvi, Shah Waliullah Dehlvi, and we have our own schools of Islam. The Deobandi school, surprisingly, is a completely different interpretation of Islam, whose influence is felt even in Central Asia. And so the marriage of Salafi jihadi concepts with Islam, Indian Islamic schools, is not so easy. You will be surprised to find there is no Muslim Brotherhood in India. Ikhwan al-Muslimin does not exist in India. It exists in Indonesia and in Malaysia. Why? Because the founders of Ikhwan al-Muslimin, the Muslim Brotherhood, paid tribute to their father Maududi in their own books. So they have left alone India because this is the place where Jamaat-e-Islami exists. It is the Maududi started the Jamaat-e-Islami. So there is, they have left this area to the Jamaat-e-Islami. The person who, so we need to, and Maududi is more popular, the most popular Indian, I would say, because he was born in Aurangabad and he lived majority of his life in India. And he hated Pakistan to begin with, although later in life he went to Pakistan. But Maududi is extremely popular in the Muslim world, in the Arab world, in North Africa and other places, more than Amitabh Bachchan or Shah Rukh Khan, where they watch these movies. But Maududi's influence is profound. We don't know about Maududi here. So what we need to understand is that the Indian version of Islam, I will not say it is always moderate, but it comes in somehow, it comes in contestation with the Arabic developments of Arabic movements. And that has also insulated in. So we are more susceptible to Pakistan-based Islamic jihadism because at a societal level and at an ideological level, it comes from the Indian schools of Islam. And so we should be more worried about the Pakistani groups. And somehow Lashkar and Jaish-e-Mohammed, Lashkar is actually Ahl-e-Hadith, more Wahhabized, and Jaish-e-Mohammed is a Deobandi school. So they are able to somehow package that in a more subcontinental manner in the Urdu vernacular. There is also, you will be surprised to find that Al-Qaeda and ISIS don't even like the Mughals. For them, kingship is haram. So their literature never glorifies even an Aurangzeb. For them, even an Aurangzeb is a murtad. So that is why those messages don't resonate here. The other problem for Al-Qaeda and ISIS is that when they talk of an Islamic state, Indian Muslim has already gone through that, that churning and has been completely exhausted by that. And Indian Muslims have said, okay, wo Pakistan ban gaya aur uska bhi hashar dekh liya humne. So when somebody talks about creating an Islamic state, it does not resonate as much with the Indian Muslim as it may resonate with Muslims in Europe or the second or third generation Muslim European coming from an Algerian descent or a Turkish descent. So that's why India has its own problems of radicalism, but it is to a great extent insulated from the global jihadist. I'm saying to a great extent. I'm not saying that it doesn't exist or it may not flare up later. It is more, that's why surprisingly, because North India went through that process of partition. In South India, that was not felt as much. And also because South India is more open because of the Shafi'i school of Islamic law, which is closer to the Wahhabi, some parts of the Wahhabi ideology. And because of the linkages with the Arab world. So South India has been more susceptible to the Salafi jihadist indoctrination. Now we have to see that there are these subcategories which the Westerners like to make the whole Aristotelian idea of making analysis of breaking down everything. And so this appears very nice in research works. The counterterrorism actions which are at our disposal, we need to have strategic communication programs, legislative measures, prison programs, tolerance promoting education programs, especially in seminaries and madrasas, intercultural dialogue we need to develop. The surprising thing to me is that I receive a lot of Urdu letters in IDSA because nobody else, no Hindu knows Urdu now, which is a very big problem. Now there are two communities which do not know about each other. The way the Muslim mind works, the Indian doesn't know. What is the difference between an Akali and a Nirankari? We don't know. What is the difference between a Devbandi and a Bareilly? Both are cities of India. So as Indians, I have found many Muslim scholars of India reading Norwegian books on Devband of Norwegian scholars and not going to that Western UP hamlet and trying to find it firsthand from there. So as Indians, we have become more and more isolated and alienated. The Muslim who's in Old Delhi, he makes a lot of money because he may be a kasai or a butcher, but he lives in his own country. He is to an extent isolated from the rest of India. The Indian Muslim is not becoming as mainstream as we would want. In fact, he's becoming more alienated. With linkages from the Gulf, they are able to get money from there. They don't mix with the general population as much. There was this idea of how we should do away with ghettoization in cities. But I would say that if there is more participation of, if Muslims are included even in jobs, because for a larger portion of the day, if you are with other communities, you will not tend to dehumanize them. So we also, maybe there are many opinions about the Sarkaria Commission, but if you have reservation of Muslims in jobs, you could at least ensure that these many Muslims would be interacting with other communities and vice versa. So we need to create these interactions more. The greater isolation of how we are, two different cultures. Every event has a different narrative in the Hindu community and a completely different narrative in the Muslim community. And the Muslim community is increasingly becoming silent. Apart from Uwaisi, in one way, it's a good thing that at least it's a cathartic discharge and we come to know about what the Muslim world is thinking. But we need more vocal voices, voices which speak out about what is going on within. Otherwise, if the Muslim community becomes so silent, we do not know what insidious influences could draw them into more radical ways of thinking. So we need to bring about some kind of all these big leaders of the past, from Queen Elizabeth to Akbar and others, they used to create a cultural ethos out of the religious silos. So you had poets try to create a kind of bringing various communities together, creating a kind of an Indian identity. That has to be done. Culture is also one of the means for de-radicalizing people. And culture also makes them less violent. So if you promote poetry and philosophy and all that, and it is shared by the larger masses, and they develop their own national ideology, ethos, I would say, not a national ideology in that sense. So we could be able to overcome many of these radical fundamentalist mazhabi oriented ideologies which we are confronting with. Somehow we are not trying to give it due attention. We are only looking at security based measures. And when we are talking of counter narratives, it is also wrong to say that all these groups are generally only driven by religious radical ideology. There is a very strong political message which comes there. In fact, much of ISIS and Al-Qaeda literature, after the first flourishes of Islamic mantras, it comes down to what is happening in Afghanistan, what is happening in here and there. So we also need to give political counter narratives when it comes to Kashmir, when it comes to Afghanistan, when it comes to other things. And somehow they also feed off what is appearing in the media. If the media is seen as being biased, if the media, because the Kashmiri, I asked a Kashmiri, he says that he did not like Arnab Goswami. He said that half of Kashmir has been radicalized by Arnab Goswami. That was obviously an exaggerated statement. But what he was trying to say is the Kashmiri is getting more and more alienated because of some of the narratives which are coming from mainstream Indian media and all that. So we cannot look upon these things in isolation. And and they had a great regard for some of the other journalists like Ravish and others. So I'm just saying that we need to have a more interactive, a more involved society, and we need to develop a common socio-cultural ethos. And that is actually something which we should not look upon ke haan, koi shayari kar raha hai, koi ye toh, what is. It actually helps in building a national consensus and an ethos and a set of values which we all cherish together. And there we are faltering. And that's, I would like to end it here, and I'll take whatever questions come my way.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Adil. So let's keep the ball rolling. So I will pose three questions which really was triggered because of your very erudite presentation. In fact, it was very expanding and expansive to say, you know, it covers a lot of things as such. My first question is that why, when you look into the discourses, the angst narrative gets more, attention rather than the reasoning narrative. You know, earlier with you, whenever there was incidents within communities, there was a need to reason it, you know, why this has happened. Now there is a flaw maybe in our social discourses that there is an angst which sells more rather than the reasoning which we used to be the what is called the bedrock of Indian society, Indian structure as such. So why is that has happened? The second question is that when you look into counter-radicalization initiative and all those things, I don't think neither from the society nor from the government engaging those scholars which are prudent, which are rational, and which might really show the glimpse that what exactly is the basic core ethos of the Islamic society and jurisprudence, and what exactly is there? We have hardly seen any document, which both Hindus and Muslims will definitely go through it. And I don't know why there is a reluctance to engaging that kind of a discourse. I would say that in terms of interfaith dialogues also, India is not done very good in that context. We are just hopeless, you know. And third question is that when you look into this counter-radicalization and terrorism and all those aspects, yes, I acknowledge that POTA and TADA and all were draconian laws. They have created more you know, anger and angst among the communities and societies. There is no denying of the fact. But the thing is that in terms of reporting, you know, this communities coming together and saying, look, this is the thing which is happening, kindly take note of it. Because we have seen society's resilience, you know, resistance to that kind of a movement, which was there. I myself knew that when I was very kid, I used to go to all those iftar parties. They used to make me sit down and all those. Now that kind of interaction has completely, you know, dissipated. And this, I just wanted your reflections on all of these. Thank you.
Yeah, I completely agree with you on all counts. And I would say that this question of identity has become very important. Somehow identity politics, to an extent, left is also to be blamed for this. There is this thing that you are a minority, and then it is right to actually fight for your rights if you feel discriminated because you are in a minority, but to have it as a hang up, as that you are always aggrieved, that everyone is conspiring against you, that you have this huge problem of persecution complex of some kind. That gives into this feeling of angst. Sab hamare khilaaf hain, sab hamare, that has happened over because the kind of success in life they were looking for. Capitalism gives you this idea that if you have it in you, you will be very successful. But it actually doesn't deliver that. Only few people become successful. And then when economic measure is only the only measure for success, now people feel inadequate and left out. So there is no other measure of success. Suppose if you are a professor and if you are a writer, you may not have made a lot of money, but if you are respected in society for your contribution, and that is seen as a mark of success. So because of so many other things which should be made, not just the GDP or not the so-called standard of living in economic terms is the measure. I think there we need to work a little more. And the idea that anybody could be successful. There is also, whenever we take anything to the extreme, individualism to the extreme, we should be having time to develop a sense of community. We don't have a time to interact with people and to socialize as much because of the kind of economic system we have right now. And that comes in the way of somebody on the web, what is he reading and how is he? Everybody is an island and making his own ideology. So we have become socially deficient in many ways, impaired in many ways. So we need to get the society in order, and we should look upon these issues as a sociological issue. It is not a political, it manifests itself as a security problem and as a political problem. But there's something not right with the way you just are in this rat race of earning as much money as possible and somehow sending your children to school so that they also make their livelihoods. What about life? Why don't we talk of life? I think there only academics can come up with solutions for that. And then this issue of political parties want to win elections. That is their goal. And they all choose one kind of an ideology for which they see there is a market. And they market that ideology. So to expect that they would like to bring about some kind of bringing communities together and working, sometimes that comes in their way of trying to divide societies and make their way, whether it is casteism, whether it is religious thing, whatever. So So governments hardly today have the time to govern. They are mostly worried about the next election. Even a majority government thinks about the next state elections. So somehow that has, there's also this thing, if suppose you have a counter-radicalization program, and if there are a few cases which you are not able to, there are a few dropouts who actually become terrorists after that. You should look upon that as not as a complete failure. It is like the goalkeeper's job. He would have a few goals, but you should look at the saves. So just saying that there are 20% recidivism or 30% recidivism, but you should see that 70% of the people were saved to an extent. So I think the whole idea that we should not enter into the counter-narrative exercise or counter-radicalization exercise because of these instances, so and so, he did this training and still he went and exploded himself somewhere. That should not be a deterrent. In fact, we should try to make more efforts so that we improve further, because we don't have the answers right now, but it will come with time the more we engage in these activities. And the same thing applies to POTA and TADA. If we made mistakes, and some of them would be glaring mistakes, and we should be open and we should acknowledge that. But that does not mean that we throw the baby along with the bathwater. We need also action by the security forces. We cannot say that only by using sociological means or all these fanciful ideas. We need security agencies to fight against terror and radical forces. And we also need the right legislation to deliver justice. And there should not be a miscarriage of justice. But just because of a few cases and instances where POTA has gone wrong or TADA may have gone wrong, that does not mean that we should just do away with all of these. Somehow that has been the way. If there are a few failures, a few setbacks, we just become against it. And even many academicians, they become skeptical, and the civil liberties people become very skeptical about it. We have to refine them, definitely. And the points which they make against these laws are many times they are right in what they are saying. But then we should try to refine that rather than completely do away with it. I will say this much.
Thank you. Any other questions, please?
Sir, Ryan and I have questions. So I'll let Ryan go first.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. It was a very interesting presentation. So I have one question and one clarification that I want. So I'll start with the clarification thing. You had mentioned while talking about madrasas that they aren't really a threat in European countries, but then France has also red flagged several of them. So could you clarify that? And my question is, right now you were talking about POTA and UAPA towards the end of the session. So POTA was repealed on the grounds of being a very draconic law, but more often than not, even UAPA is considered to be very draconian. So are there any reforms that you would have worked on in the past as proposals to change in UAPA?
Yeah, I think regarding the first question, that is also a question rather than a clarification. I would say that in France has its own idea of secularism, and it has been contested by America of all countries. It actually becomes a little radical even when it comes to liberalism. It actually champions liberalism more emphatically, what they say, muscular liberalism. That's the term which they use. So any ideology which does not speak of rationality and does not try to champion the scientific temper is supposed to be a problem. And I agree with it. It is a problem. However, if a madrasa is giving a faith-based indoctrination or teaches all of that, that itself is considered to be a problem. Like Tablighi Jamaat was recently banned by Saudi Arabia. Tablighi Jamaat never was allowed to operate in Saudi Arabia anyway. It was only because in some private circles Tablighi Jamaat was operating, so they have legally done it, but no Islamic movement was ever allowed in Saudi Arabia. Same is the case with France, which is taking a more hands-on approach in fighting radicalism. And it is then even questioning those ideological trends which facilitate that kind of a radicalization, which is contestable. I mean, if someone like a Sufi, if you go to the Sufi discourse, they will talk about, in my dream, I saw a Buzurg coming and telling me, you wear this charm or amulet and you will get passed in your exam. So the scientific mind will not accept it. So even that is considered to be regressive. Tablighi Jamaat, by the way, only talks about the seventh heaven or what happens in the grave. It hardly talks about politics. But still, that leads to a very regressive mindset. So to that extent, you can say that it is conducive to a more narrow-minded approach to life and to the world, which then helps a person to become a fundamentalist and a terrorist by that extent. So that is a debatable issue. It is also possible that Salafi jihad, at the same time, the Salafi jihadist groups are operating in these places and they overtly give jihadist message in these madrasas. It is possible. Please do not take any of my statements as being completely true or being absolute. Only extremists take statements in an absolutist manner. So that is always going to be a little bit of a way. But around the world we have found, and even some of the very high level intelligence officials I have met, they have said that most Indian Muslim radicals have had university education or modern schooling. Very few of the madrasa graduates indulge in violent extremism. It comes more out of a sense of guilt. We are not religious enough. We should know Islam more. Why are they doing it to the Muslim world? This whole idea of engaging in philosophical and political discussions. Islam it has been called an orthopraxy, not an orthodoxy. Islam, the people from madrasa offer namaz 5 times a day and Ramadan, roza is all time a day. You don't have time to think about a lot if you are doing all of this. It is the less practicing Muslim who gets enough time to think about these issues, like the Jamaat-e-Islami people who will always talk about political issues and these and that. Similarly, you will find even the many of the political activists in the Hindu community, people like Savarkar actually was quite against many of the values of the orthodox Hindu religion. He wanted cow slaughter and all those things. So surprisingly, the less practicing people are and more intellectual people create more problems when it comes to radicalization. It is not unlike the only probable exception definitely is the madrasas in Pakistan and Afghanistan, which were made to create jihadis. I'm making a bold statement here, and I'm not saying that it is all to be taken at face value. There will be exceptions. Draconian laws are taken. Sometimes they are needed. Sometimes situations are dire. You need to take those. You can argue that since 1958, AFSPA is there in the Northeast. Perhaps time has come to repeal them. It is arguable. But there was a time when it was needed there. The other message here is that if we go overboard in misusing a law, then our whole purpose will be defeated. So Indian security services and the government should understand that if they are having such a law, we should only use it very intelligently. And we should not go overboard in that. But I don't think that, there are uses of certain laws for certain time. If there is a patient, what you give in as kind of a drug to that patient at that time may be very useful. It may not be hygienic. You do not give it to a healthy person, but maybe that kind of a little bit of poison may be useful for that patient at that time. So I would see it in that respect.
Okay, so I have a question now for Professor. And then we have one more question in our chat box. So my question is, in Indian cities, it's been noted that there is this sense of ghettoization where communities are sort of segregated or like limited to a specific locality. So is there something that the Indian government or the city planning committee could do to sort of reduce this kind of segregation that we see in cities?
Yes, that is a big challenge. And the surprising thing is that even when new cities are made and new localities are made, like Trilokpuri, where I'm living here in Delhi, it has had many communal incidents, but it has only come up in the last 20, 30 years. At that time, nothing was thought about. At least at that time, they should have thought about not ghettoizing certain areas and all that. So we do not think in those terms still. That level of awareness is not there when new areas are coming up. In Gurgaon, are there enough mosques that the Muslims feel that they should go out in the open and offer namaz? That could be one of the issues which are there. Haryana never had a large Muslim population. And so the Haryana government never faced this issue of namaz. UP has always been having too many Muslims. So there the ethos is different. So I'm just saying that we need to take these issues more seriously. And town planning and city planning is something which we should be looking into also from the sociological and the communal issues and all those perspectives. And the other thing is that we should also study humanities and arts. There is a complete, if I don't understand Ghalib, and there are many people who don't understand Ghalib, I'm not introduced to the Muslim culture and ethos. If I don't understand Maitri Sharan Gupta and many of Ramdhari Singh Dinkar, if the culture is completely finished, and we are speaking in English right now, so that shows that we are getting increasingly alienated from a very big community which does not speak the language we speak. And so that is another kind of a ghettoization. And there are so many different cultures and so many different Indias within this India. You would be amazed. So somehow it's not just the Muslim issue. It's the so many other cultures are thriving in India, which we are unaware of. So many social and economic sections of society are so completely different in the way they live. And that is why the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. We are not as well-knit a society. We have to be an Indian society. We just cannot be an Indian state. And efforts have to be made in that regard.
Thank you so much, sir. So we have one question in the chat box. I'll read it out. It's from Yukti. She asks, you mentioned that there is an increasing sense of isolation between Hindus and Muslims. So if we want to understand more of the thinking of Muslims, especially Indian Muslims, where do we start? And where and how do we start?
I think we should understand that Muslim does not mean Islam. We should not conflate Islam with Muslims. Just as we should not conflate Hindu with Vedas and Ramayana and Mahabharata. There is much more to a Muslim than Islam. There is also a lot of culture. There is also a lot of poetry. There is also a lot of drama. Every Muslim, good or bad, is not acting just because the religion is telling him so. If there have been bad Muslims or good Muslims, they are not because they are good or bad Muslims because they follow Islam. It is a culture. Actually, if you read Hodgson, he says that the whole Islamic civilization was an Islamicate. It was not Islam. They took so much from other cultures around them. So the conflation of Islam with Muslims is a problem. And if we need to start, we should understand Islamic culture. And so why not study some of the cultural aspects, some of the poetry, some of the philosophy? Why can't we study Ibn Rushd, Averroes, or Al-Farabi and some of these great philosophers? So there is much more to, and at present, if you want to understand Indian Muslims, can please go to Old Delhi, try to meet the people there, try to understand what they say, try to also go to the Urdu blogosphere, where there is a lot of debate on Muqallid kaun hai or Ghalib Muqallid kaun hai. And actually, it is a big debate which is happening in the Muslim world right now. So we need to understand the Muslim mind, how it functions. And for that, we need to read the literature. We need to interact with Muslims more. And same is the case with Muslims. Muslims also need to understand the other side. The surprising thing is that when religion was the predominant power in the world, science came up and it started questioning religion. Religion had very little answers for science at that time. Now, religion is not understood, and religion asks a lot of questions. And the people who are from the scientific community do not know religion and do not know cultures. And that is why they are getting weaker in combating the threats which are emanating from there. So we need to, we cannot leave religion as something, because the liberal ideology says religion is like passe. We need to understand it. Whenever there is a blind spot, it will come and hit you. So the problem is happening because we left many things unattended, and we need to look into those.
Okay.
Am I able to satisfy to some extent some of the questions asked?
Yes, sir. Thank you. There's one more question. From Masha, so any suggestions that you have for clear and present danger that we face in Kerala, which is towing the land of Kashmir, like radicalizing the youth participation in ISIS or Afghanistan or Iraq, rampant use of the madrasas for radicalization and increased surfacing of radicalized youth, drugs, hawala, money and weapons?
I think what there should be a two-pronged approach. One should be that there are, like, the Dajjaj is a seminary in Yemen. Most of the Kerala people, they have links with that seminary and also in Afghanistan. And we find that Maldives is becoming increasingly radicalized, and probably in the next elections, Yameen has a good chance of coming to power. So the coming of Taliban to power has brought back the fear that Islamism will become a major threat, because with the decline of ISIS a couple of years back, even the jihadis started questioning whether violence works. But the way in which America left Afghanistan and handed it over to Taliban, I mean, on a platter, and without any of the conditions of the Doha Agreement even applying right now, that has come as a great encouragement to the jihadist and Islamist forces around the world. It has become a major threat. For India also, the coming of Taliban in Afghanistan, if Taliban succeeds, there is a problem. If it does not succeed, more radical groups will come out. Do not expect that if Taliban goes, a democratic system will emerge in Afghanistan. America has left that country altogether. So we are in for some very dire times. Now, one of the ways is that it is the Muslim community in India which can work as a bulwark against the threats which we are facing. We need to engage the Indian Muslim community even more, I would say, rather than allow it to fall into the hands of those people who are trying to radicalize it. And we have to see what we could negotiate and accept in those communities, what ideas of Islamic culture and Islamic values we can use for our national ethos, and what we should say, no, this is not allowed. You cannot just say all 10 points I will not accept. You have to accept a few things to make these people, the Muslim community, part of you. And we also need to probably reach out to some of the secular elements in Pakistan, because Pakistan is also on the verge of becoming more Islamized and more radicalized. And also as a state, it may fail. Now we have to see, if there is a failed state of Pakistan, it will be more of a problem for us. We will not have anybody to talk to. Now at least we can blame the military, and at least the Western world could pressurize Pakistan on FATF or through other means. But if Pakistan becomes more radicalized, we'll have a bigger problem on hand. So we need to find new ways of engaging with the Muslim community, and also to see where we can help them, and where, what all we can redress, and where we need to draw the line. But in a very, we have to engage directly with the problem. We cannot just call all Muslims as a problem community or the whole of Islam as a problem community. The other thing is also when we say that a Salafi is a problem, Salafi Islam is a problem, that is also very dangerous. Right now, the Salafi Wahhabi Saudi Arabia is one of our best allies. If you look at the Gulf, about 1 crore of our population is in the Gulf, not in Iran, not in Shia Iran. And Shia Iran is also no less of an Islamist than any other Islamist. They kill more people there every day, every Juma, than they are killed in Saudi Arabia these days. So to say that a particular sect of Salafis are bad people and Sufis are good people, that also we have to be more nuanced in our understanding and in our dealings than the stereotypes which sometimes we create. And we need to always be open to seeing the situation unfold as it does, trying to get over our own hang-ups which we have. Otherwise, we would have a major problem on our hands. We have to be on the vigil.
Okay, so I think these were all the questions we have for you for now. Thank you so much, sir. Now I would request Ryan to give the word of thanks.
On behalf of the Center for Security Studies, I'd like to extend our gratitude to Dr. Adil Rashid to take out time from his busy schedule to address the event. Thank you for imparting us with your sound knowledge on the topic, and I'm sure that everyone in attendance will take back with them some of the concrete points discussed today. A special thanks to Center Director Professor Dr. Pankaj Jha for providing the means and immense support to make this edition of the online lecture series successful. I'd also like to thank everyone for making time to join this event. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It has been a privilege. Thank you for having me here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rashid.
Thank you so much, sir.